Thank you very much for coming. We have an amazing topic tonight, something that I know about these things for a long time, but I never get around to really studying them until I prepare for these classes. And I'm just so amazed with the range and depth and breadth and fascinating elements of Jewish history. It really is tremendous. Tonight's topic, we're going to look at the incredible Rabenu Bahya, also known as Rami Bahaye. We'll talk about the pronunciation of his name shortly, who is the author of a classic, a very creative and pioneering work in Jewish history, the Hovot, ha-Levavot, the Duties of the Heart. Very important work that, I hope I can say everything I need to say within the next 60 minutes or so, maybe a little less. I have to start with a joke. Last week, it was not so successful. I think I had fun, but when I viewed them again, I ended up cutting out so much of the Ibn Gabiro lectures. If you like the jokes, feel privileged because the rest of the internet is not getting them. It's only for you guys, but let's try this one, okay? This is actually a joke that I've told maybe 3 or 4 times, and I never managed to get it right, although I have to say it's probably one of my favorite jokes in the whole world. It has a tremendous depth to it. I just don't know why I can't get the punchline right. So it goes like this. You have to understand a little bit of cultural background. This is one of the famous cycle of chelm jokes. Chelm in Ashkenazi cultural mythology is a town that is filled with fools. And there are all kinds of jokes and stories about Chelm Jews that are sometimes uncomplimentary. Sometimes they show a strange kind of subversive wisdom, like the famous joke, this is a bonus joke, not the one I was planning to tell, about the Chelm family is sitting around the breakfast table one morning, and the father is getting his breakfast ready, he drops a piece of bread on the floor, and they look down, and he's shocked. And he calls everyone over, his wife and his kids come over, and they look, and it landed butter side up. And they don't know what it means. Oh my gosh, I dropped the bread. Look, it landed butter side up. They had no idea what to do. They didn't know, should they move it? Should they touch it? Well, they decide to go talk to the rabbi, because whenever something is deeply troubling like this, you got to go to the rabbi. So they went to the rabbi, and the rabbi says, are you sure? I said, yes, we all saw it. We brought in witnesses, kosher witnesses, not related to each other, the whole thing. And he says, okay, I have to check the books. So the rabbi goes into the library in his home, and he pulls out all the big tomes of the Talmud and Kabbalah and things like that. And he's looking everywhere for an answer, and everyone's waiting. And meanwhile, the entire shtetl is kind of gathered around the rabbi's house. They've heard this amazing thing, and they don't know, what does it mean? Is it a messianic sign or something? Finally, the rabbi emerges from his study, and he's drenched in sweat. He's obviously been exerting himself intellectually to find out the answer. And he says, I have the answer. And they say, what is it, Rabbi? He says, you buttered the wrong side. There's a Jewish humor in there. Okay, maybe I'll save the other joke till later if I find the next place. So tonight's topic is Rabenu Bahya. Absolutely amazing topic. Such a creative and foundational thinker that has received so little treatment in the literature. It's surprising how few lectures, for example, there are on YouTube about this topic. I'm glad to be contributing this one. Okay, so some good and welfare just to before beginning today. Our lecture is sponsored by an anonymous donor who is supporting our students for Refuah Shelema, which is the Hebrew term for a complete healing for Mordechai ben Batya. You should have Refuah Shelema, you should have a complete healing, and we should know no more tsar. Another very quick kind of cool piece of information. For the internet audience, I'm gonna put a little kind of thing at the end of this lecture with more information, but I'm delighted that I was asked to lead a tour into Portugal and Spain this summer. It's a riverboat tour that's going to go from the shoreline of Portugal into Spain. It has all kinds of road trips on the side, and really, it looks fantastic. It looks so cool. Watch the internet version. You'll see some of the pictures from the trip at the end of it. Also very important, good and welfare. Next week, I have parent-teacher interviews. So that is a very high priority. I love learning history with all of you, but I gotta make sure that I'm there for my parent-teacher interviews. Not because I really want to, but because my wife will kill me if I don't show up. No, but it is really important, obviously. So we're gonna skip next week. We won't have a lecture here. I may send out something on the internet in advance, so if you're on the mailing list, you'll get a post, God willing. But otherwise, there's no class here next week. We'll convene again the week after. And here's one last good and welfare thing. So this is more for the internet than this audience, but I get, you know, I shouldn't do this first thing in the morning, but sometimes when I, you know, after I finish davening and things like that, I turn on my YouTube and I look at the comments and I try to respond to some of them. And every now and then, you know, maybe about 5% of the comments are really nasty anti-Semitic ones. YouTube does a really good job of you know, immediately deleting the ones that are really offensive, but sometimes they get through and then it kind of ruins my day for about 15 minutes and I have to forget about it. So this one bothered me a little bit. This one was in last week's lecture. I've wiped out the name. It says, since most Jews in the United States, rather Jinos, I had to look that up, it stands for Jews in Name Only, and it's based of a part of a really bizarre, complicated anti-Semitic myth that today's Ashkenazic Jews are actually descended from the Khazars, who we've talked about in previous lectures. We're not real Jews. We are descended from the Khazars. Are leftists. They hate history and are constantly trying to revise it. This makes it hard to raise money for true history. So I'm not exactly sure what he's getting at, but I think he's throwing a little jab at the fact that we have not met our $100,000 goal for scholarships yet. So the way to deal with these guys, I'm going to delete him later. But in the meantime, support our students, all of you on the internet. It doesn't matter how much. Go online and deal with people like this and say that we don't care, we want to keep learning, and we will help our students get through their undergraduate degree. Okay, enough good and welfare, let's go straight to the actual material. So who was Rabenu Bahya? One of the most difficult things about this particular topic is that we know so little about Rabenu Bahya. In fact, these are the two volumes, this is a kind of like the classic printing of Rabenu Bahya in the late 20th century version, and this is everything we really know about him. There's hardly any material about him in the medieval world. We barely know when he lived or where he lived, and most of the information that we get is based on internal literary evidence alone. Even though he was clearly a scholar of towering proportions, and his creativity literally started a major genre in Jewish literature. Nevertheless, we know very little about his life. When he was born, when he died, we have a hint, one word, as to what he did for a living. Let's have a look at what we do know, most of which can be expressed on just the title page of this one book. Let's check it out. So this is the Hebrew title page, Toras Chovas ha-Levavos, which is a beautiful title. The word Torah, of course, is used here in the sense of teaching, right? The word Torah comes from hora'a, to instruct. So the teaching of the obligations of the heart. In Hebrew, it's in plural, but in English, it's like hair is plural and singular in English. So the obligation of the heart, and what the whole book is about, refers to how, and we'll return to this, so much of Jewish literature is all about the obligation of the limbs. Where do you have to be at a certain time? What do you have to do? Where do you have to go? What do you have to eat? What do you have to not eat? It's all about physicality. It's all about the body. What do you do with your body? That's the mitzvot. But there's very little discussion in a concerted way, but what do you do with your heart? How are you supposed to focus your heart? That's what we'll be engaged in for most of today's hour. But at any rate, that's the title, Teachings of the Duties of the Heart. And then below it, it's written here, Chibru b'leshon Aravit harav hagadol achasid, written in Arabic by the great and pious rabbi. The Arabic original is extant, and we have new translations made directly from the Arabic, although overwhelmingly we have relied on the 12th century Hebrew translation that we'll look at in the next slide. So we know he's a great and pious rabbi. What else do we know? His our teacher, Rabenu. This term, Rabenu, is actually a fairly high-level honorific. Very few people in Jewish history received the term Rabenu, especially until the modern era. The Hasidic movement, I think, co-opted it such that just about every Hasidic leader becomes a Rabenu. But before the 19th century in particular, Rabenu was reserved for really unique individuals. Like, for example, Moshe Rabenu, right? Moses, our teacher. Not too many people at that level. So we know he is an important person. Rabenu Bahya. Now, this is the hard part. The name that we have transliterated into Hebrew is spelled Beit Chet Yud Yud. The nekudot, the vowels, of course, are arbitrary, and no one's exactly sure how to pronounce his name. The customary pronunciation is Bahya, but it's not a regular Hebrew spelling at all. Bahya would be something like Beit Chet Yud He, maybe. But people say Bahya. Some people also say Bahya, which is also not exactly right. This would be a shva, so it would be like Bahya, which is kind of weird. No one's exactly sure how to say his name, but we have certain conventions. And we know his surname, son of Yosef. The family name is apparently Pikuda, or Pikuda. And he is finally, we know he was Hadayan HaSafaradi, the Sephardic judge, or judge from Spain. Now, how do we know that these encomiums on the title page are true? It's because they're taken from the 12th century translation of Ibn Tibbon, which is the closest to Rabenu Bahya that we have. Okay, here's the bottom part of it. It says, translated into the holy tongue, by Rabbi Yehuda Ibn Tibbon. And there's some fascinating things with Ibn Tibbon. It's a fascinating thing. Ibn Tibbon was the progenitor of a multi-generation family of translators in Provence, in particular in France, who were rendering Sephardic Arabic classics into Hebrew. Again, this is a period when in the 12th century, when the Almohads come in and the Al-Andalus period of the golden era begins to wane with the Orthodox Muslim persecution of the kind of cosmopolitan environment. And so Arabic readers are fleeing from Spain, including Maimonides, we saw before, Yehuda Halevi leaves and others. The Alfasi, ironically, moves to Spain at this point. But this is a period when Sephardic Jewish culture in Spain is in decline, and it's now being transmitted to a new generation in Christian Europe. So Ibn Tibbon and his children and his grandchildren were all well-versed in Arabic, and they rendered almost all of these great classics, the Mora Nevuchim, the Guide for the Perplexed, the Kuzari that we spoke about a few weeks ago. It all came from Ibn Tibbon's translation house. This, amazingly, is the very first work of Sephardic Arabic literature that Ibn Tibbon chose to render into Hebrew. It's my contention, I haven't read it anywhere else, but I think it's true. It's my contention that he chose this over Maimonides. Well, actually, Maimonides would be difficult because I don't think he wrote the guide at that point, but he chose him over Yehuda Halevi, he chose him over so many other authors because Hovot ha-Levavot was so unique and original. It was a path-breaking work, and that's why Ibn Tibbon chose to start what ended up being a massive translation project with this particular work. And then, just to make it a little more complicated, it has a modern translation by Pinchas Yehuda Lieberman. So I didn't actually bother taking a typical sample page, but if you can sort of see when I hold up mine, there's on the top there's a few paragraphs in one Hebrew font. Can you zoom in on this there, David, just for fun? Let's see how close you can get. I don't know, how does it look? Yeah. Can you read it okay? What if I do like this? No. Anyways, okay. So the on the top there's the Hebrew translation of Ibn Tibbon, but because Ibn Tibbon, as he mentions in his introduction, you know, he wants very much to try and preserve the language of of Rabenu Bahya as precisely as possible, he renders Arabic terms in Hebrew characters with little comment. And so you have all these obscure philosophic terms that make sense to Arabic readers but don't make sense to Hebrew readers. It's very difficult. So there's been a tradition of retranslating Ibn Tibbon, often by people who don't read Arabic but read Hebrew well, and they render it into an easier Hebrew, which I tended to read much more. It takes a little longer because it takes more words to explain the concepts, but the more modern Hebrew, in this case is a 20th century translation, is just a little bit easier to access. There is also a very fine English translation as well. It's been published by Feldheim. Another edition that I consulted online, an English edition. But that's the problem with working with a translation, is that you know, translations themselves are already a step back from the original. But that's how we access Hovot ha-Levavot, and that's where I should go on to the next slide at this point. So where did he come from? Zaragoza, also spelled with S's, but this is apparently the official spelling. You can see it's in northern Spain, close to the Pyrenees Mountains. We really don't know anything about him, and in fact, there's huge question marks about exactly when he lived. We know certainly he have to have lived before Ibn Tibbon, because Ibn Tibbon published the translation in 1160. We also notice that there are some strong similarities in a couple passages between the work of Ibn Gabirol that we spoke about last week. So that means that one borrowed from the other, or potentially they were contemporaries sharing the same source. Some of it is kind of bizarre. Like, you remember that square we looked at with the five different, or the four different character traits and the four different elements and things like that. So that appears also in Rabenu Bahya. The scholar Diane Lobel, who we'll speak about in a second, she estimates that based on a Geniza fragment written by Ibn Ezra, who refers to Rabenu Bahya as the previous generation, more or less we can ballpark the authorship of this book around 1080. So that's as close as we get in terms of knowing anything about his life. Everything else is going to be internal scholarship, internal literary evidence. Okay, so at this point, we have to pause and have a little bit more of a philosophical discussion about what is this book, why is it so distinct and special. This is an amazing 19th century painting by Karl Schleicher. The title is Eine Streitsfrage aus dem Talmud, and it translates as a controversy question out of the Talmud, or meaning a machlokus from the Talmud. I just like the word Streitsfrage. You know, it sounds like a controversy, like ich habe ein Streitsfrage für dich. You know, I got a problem with you, buddy. My wife says, by the way, that when I speak German, I sound like I'm angry, and she wants me to tone it down somehow. German is one of our secret languages that we speak when we don't want our kids to figure out what we're saying. And they figure it all out. They know everything. Anyways, okay, so this is a picture my grandmother, Allah Shalom, used to own. And I always liked it when I was a kid because it shows, you know, rabbis engaged in a Talmudic discussion. Now, besides that very short art history moment, what exactly is Jewish philosophy? Let's back the statement up a little bit and say, what exactly is philosophy? If we look at the Greek tradition of philosophy, and as Whitehead put it, all philosophy is footnotes to Plato, philosophy is basically an attempt to understand the universe starting from zero. No assumptions. You build logic. From logic, you take premises, develop syllogisms. You have proposals, hypotheses. thesis, antithesis, synthesis, all kinds of different models to try and create an understanding of the fabric of reality. You can break it up into different schools or different disciplines, you know, epistemology, metaphysics, things like that. But ultimately, philosophy begins with the search for wisdom, and that is in fact what the word philosophy means. Sophia in Greek means wisdom. Philo means I love. I love wisdom, philosophy. And what characterizes Western philosophy, drawing from Plato, is the Socratic idea that we know nothing. And in order to know anything, we must start from zero. This is perhaps why undergraduates love it so much, because it's like being in the sandbox and you have nothing created and you have to build it up from nothing. On the other hand, is it fair to say that this is a Jewish activity? With some rare exceptions until the modern era, I would say no. We use the term Jewish philosophy, but Jewish philosophy does not start from zero. Jewish thought, if we can use that word probably more appropriately, that term, Jewish thought starts from some, you know, what the Germans would call Grundlage, like foundation points. There are places where you got to start. You got to start with, for example, Torah Misinai, revelation. You start with, you know, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. There are certain, like, premises which are, like, axioms that are non-negotiable, and we build from there. What does God want us to do with this universe? What is the practical outcome of our understanding of this universe? That goes into Jewish thought, and we're very good at that. That's why we have such a profoundly deep legal tradition, because we explore the material and real implications of the foundational principles with which we were given. I'll tell you a true story. I heard this from a student who's at a particular law school in the Midwest, and it's near a local yeshiva. And every year in Law 1, there's a whole bunch of boys from the yeshiva who are studying, you know, they're in law school, and they're sitting usually at the back in their white shirts and, you know, dark pants and things like that. And the professor, who is a fairly well-known professor, he does the survey class, at the end of the class says, and before everyone is dismissed, I would like all of the young men from the rabbinical seminary to please come down and speak with me privately. So after all the other students file out, and, you know, the 20 or so guys from the yeshiva come down, apparently the professor says to them, he says, listen, you leave me alone, and I'll, right? So we have a very extensive legal tradition, but it's not per se philosophy the way the Greeks understand it. We have starting those. Now, when you get to the modern era, which we're not going to get to today, you will find philosophers who like to start all over, who like to say, I'm going to tear down everything that existed before and try to build it up in a way that's somehow Jewish. But that's not our agenda for today. We're looking at what we might call philosophy in the medieval environment. And that's why I think that Hovot ha-Levavot is so unusual in our tradition, because it is really the first work that synthesizes the disparate material of internal spiritual ethical life in a single study. Let me explain what I mean. As I mentioned earlier, we have a deeply sophisticated legal tradition, which begins from verses in the Torah. It goes through amplifications in the rest of the Bible, and especially in the Mishnah. And then the Talmud discusses it. The rabbis discuss it in responsa, which form legal precedents. Later, this goes into the codes and so on, which are, by the way, just about now being prepared. In 11th century, 12th century, you begin to say the early codes, like Maimonides' Mishnah Torah and so on. And that's kind of like a Jewish way of thinking about, you know, what's the tachlis? What's the bottom line? How am I supposed to behave given these conditions? But the idea of just, that's not the sole material in the religious tradition, of course. There are scattered here and there these gems of spiritual insight, that may be collected in a few places, a little bit like Pirkei Avot. Every now and then you'll see a glimmer of like kind of the internal spiritual life, but it seems to be overwhelmed, just like there are stars in the sky, but they are overwhelmed by the blackness of the expanse between those stars. What Hovot ha-Levavot did was it said, wait a second, you know, we should think systematically about our internal lives with the same kind of discipline and rigor that we speak about our halachic lives. And that's what Chovot HaLevavot is all about. He says, I'm not going to talk about, you know, how you shake the lulav or whether or not this chicken is kosher. I'm going to talk about how you should orient yourself to God, how you should focus your mind, how you should, you know, be disciplined with your relationship to the universe as a whole. It's a deeply mystical and fascinating work, and it is completely path-breaking. It is totally new, and it starts a whole genre, which, depending on who you ask, would probably be best called Musar literature. The whole idea of personal development starts with Chovot HaLevavot, not earlier. My wife and my daughter had a little text argument. By the way, for those of you who use texting, I have to say, it is the best way to have domestic disputes. You know, having an argument over a text is great because nobody interrupts you. You know, you have enough time to express yourself properly. You know, you can see the other person typing. I love it, you know. So, not that I, you know, I'm speaking theoretically, of course, because my wife and I only disagree about once every decade or so. But anyways, my daughter, who is a very dedicated Chabadnik here in Crown Heights, she shared a piece of Torah with my wife on WhatsApp, and actually it was a family WhatsApp, and my wife wrote back and said, oh, that's a nice piece of Musar. And my daughter wrote back and said, no, it's a nice piece of Chassidus, right? But it's just different words for the same kind of thing. It all starts with Chovot HaLevavot. It all starts with Rabenu Bahya, who first said, let's just think together about how we live spiritually as opposed to halachically. And we have to see a little bit about what's in there. Now, our task is to approach this from a historical perspective. I really would like to give you an introduction to the content of the book, but from a historical perspective, if we don't know more about him than the title page, how do we learn, how do we flesh out the historical context? So you've got to do an intellectual biography based on the material in the text itself, which is much harder. This is an older printing, obviously, of Chovot HaLevavot with the gate metaphor, which is quite symbolic and traditional in Jewish bibliography. Many chapters, including those of Chovot HaLevavot, are named after gates. So one of the real, now obviously, oh, I remember what I wanted to say here. Obviously, his source base is overwhelmingly Jewish in nature. He's citing verses from the Torah, passages from the Talmud, the Midrash. He is clearly well-versed in all of Tanakh. He's clearly bringing verses from all over the Torah, and that's fairly typical. Of course, we say it's typical because we base it on him. But what's surprising, and this is uniquely Sephardic, is something that has been known for about a century. He used Muslim sources as well. Specifically, the Sufi mystics, which are a group of fascinating Muslim thinkers that have a lot of ideas that resonate with Jewish values. And the stuff just slips in without any comment. I'll give you a couple of examples. And we see it repeated through many other sources. We see it, for example, Maimonides' own son, the famous Avraham ben Arambam, wrote works that are deeply infused with Sufi wisdom. I know it sounds jarring because, you know, we live in a time where Jews and Muslims tend to be locked in conflict and in Israel, and we look at God forbid, we don't want to look at them, but occasionally you see these things about ISIS and beheadings, and you just say, what do we have any common vocabulary with these people? Well, in Al-Andalus, we did, we shared, and we grew from it. So I'll give you one example here. Yes, it's in the Forbidden Gate, right? So the Forbidden Gate, let's start and I'll show you the example. Oh, let's just jump to the example and I'll come back to the Forbidden Gate. So here we go. Here's a Sufi teaching, which Diana Lobel, that I showed you earlier, she wrote a great book on Rabenu Bahya recently. So this is a 9th century, 100 years before Rabenu Bahya is, and this story is cited in 11th century hagiographies of Yahya ibn Mu'ad. It was said to Yahya ibn Mu'ad, "Tell me about God. Where is he?" Or what is he? Sorry. And by the way, this word here, abotu, that's actually a technical Muslim term. And I just made that up. That's because it's a typo. Sorry. "Tell me about God." See, when you have tenure, you can get away with things like these. "Tell me about God. What is he?" So Yahya responded, he said, "God is one." Right? That's definitely something that Jews can resonate with. "What is he like?" Strange phrase in the original. "How is he?" Like, in what manner is he? And the answer is, "An all-powerful king." The question is, "Where is he?" And then he gives a strange answer, "On the lookout." And then you have this funny coda. "It was said," I didn't ask you about that, Yahya said, "that is the description of the created. As for the description of the creator, it is what I told you." Sufis talk like this a lot. There's a fantastic book called The Origins of Consciousness by Robert Ornstein, which expands on this, but beyond our topic today. Now let's read from Rabenu Bahya, and I'll read in Hebrew and translate. "V'nishal k'tzatz ha'chachamim al ha'boire." One of the wise was asked about the creator. I have a feeling there's got to be about 30 or 40 passages, stories in here, where one of the wise is asked, an anonymous wise person. I haven't gone through the sources, but already 100 years ago, there's scholarship listing all of the passages where he borrowed from the Sufis. I have a feeling when you have this unnamed source, it probably is the Sufis. Anyways, the question is asked about the creator, "Mahu," what is he? Va'amar, the answer is, "Eloka echad." One God. God is one. Amarlo Ashoel, so the questioner asked, "The Echu, how is he?" Again, that strange language, Echu, how is he? What does it mean? In what manner is he? Amarlo Melech Gadol, a great king. That's a pretty straight translation. Amarlo Va'anahu, he said to him, "Where is he?" Amarlo, here's the Hebrew term, Bitsipia. Bitsipia. So Tsipia is probably best translated as on the lookout, watching, like at Sofeh, right? Har Hatsofim, the mountain of the lookouts. God is on the lookout. Now remember, the question is, where is he? And the answer is, what he is doing. Yeah, but it's not the right answer. The question deserves a where answer, right? You know, where are you gonna be for dinner tonight? At home, you know, that's what you say. You don't say, "Where are you going to be for dinner tonight?" Tuesday. It doesn't make sense. It's non sequitur. But the answer, the deeper answer is, as Diana Lobel explains, you can't ask where God is. By asking that question, you misunderstand the basic reality that God is everywhere. You can't say in a particular place. The question itself is absurd. Rather, where is God? Where is what God is doing? And God is looking out. Looking out for what? Looking out for us. Looking out, waiting for us. On the lookout for us. And as soon as we start to look out for God, then, the teaching goes, we are where God is. We join God, not in a place, but in activity. We meet God when we look for God. That's a beautiful idea. And you don't have to take my word for it. Rabenu Bahya likes it. And then the end of the story is the same as well. He says, Amar lo ashol, so the questioner says, Lo she'il ticha alze, I didn't ask you that. I didn't ask you what he was doing. I asked you where he was. Amar lo, so the wise one said, She'il tani b'milot ha'ela shmurot alamidot harui lo gavra, lo nivra, sorry, v'lo alboire. So you asked me with words that are appropriate for a created being. A created being can be in a place. God, who is not a created being, cannot be in any place. That is not his reality. So that's why I answered you only in terms that you would understand. Because it's impossible to explain it in any other way. So you see here, this is just one example of the many Sufi passages that Rabenu Bahya would bring into his work, which is indicative of a syncretic culture, the values of Andalusian Spain, that allowed for the communication of Muslims and Jews who are spiritual seekers to share whatever wisdom could effectively cross their otherwise rigid religious boundaries. Fascinating example. Let us just move back a little bit here to talk about the Forbidden Gate in itself. Now, the book is divided into several gates. I'll give you the whole list of contents shortly. The first gate, it's one of these ironic things in the yeshiva world, is taboo and is rarely studied in a formal setting. And in fact, in my edition here, which is a very orthodox kind of edition, I told you that there's a modern translation of the Ibn Tibbon. There's no translation of the first chapter. The first chapter is left in the original 12th century version. And moreover, there's about a 30-page introduction, which is essentially a long series of warnings. Don't read this chapter. Don't read this chapter. This is what this rabbi said, don't read this chapter. This is what this other rabbi said, don't read this chapter. So what's so forbidden about it? And of course, especially with someone like my wife, if you say a chapter is forbidden, well, she's of course going to read it. That's the first thing. I remember we once bought, sorry for sharing this with you, but I'm in a good mood, I guess. We once bought a book on marital happiness. And thank God, my wife and I have been married almost 30 years now. We bought a book on marital happiness, and it was divided into two halves. The first half was a book for husbands, written by a husband, David Abramov. And the second half was a book for wives, written by his wife, Mrs. Abramov. What's her? Tehila Abramov, I think his name. And so we agreed that I would read the first section, and I read it diligently. We were just married a few years at the time, and I made little notes and stuff like that to myself. And then I gave her the book, and she read, and I figured she would read the women's section, and we talk about it. Instead, she read the men's section, and she especially read all of the notes. And before reading her section, she had to, query me about, why did you write that? Why didn't you write this? Things like that. Okay, lost my train of thought. Okay, so why is it forbidden? The main reason it's forbidden is because, think about it, if the whole book is the duty of your heart of trying to understand your relationship to God, and we are working in a Platonic philosophical vein of starting from zero, what is the very first question you would want to ask? Who is God? What is God? That's the first thing I want. I want to have a relationship with God. Well, who is God? So the first chapter is all about who is God. And that's a very hard question to answer, even with the occasional Sufi thought. In fact, it descends into what scholars tend to call negative theology, because the only way you can effectively define God in a philosophical way is by nots. God is not limited. God is not born. God is not, if God is infinite, what else can you say about him? There is no positive attribute that you can add to God that does not intrinsically limit him from being other things. So the first chapter, which I have to say I read, I'm over 40 years old, I figured I could get away with it. I didn't understand it. But the first chapter is basically all about who is God. Now, the warnings are well placed. The Rabenu Bahya asks a lot of philosophical questions that in many yeshivas are simply taboo. You can't ask these questions. Maybe not like in an Eshet Torah kind of place, but if you are raised from childhood with a simple faith, emuna pshuta, in belief in a creator, then even opening up these kinds of questions can be very painful and difficult. Like you say, well, I never thought of that. And then all of a sudden you got 5 years of going off the derech trying to figure out, you got to get back to Yiddishkeit. So it's a very difficult thing. And that's why most yeshivas actually leave this section alone. Similarly, the opening sections of Maimonides' Yad Chazakah, the Mishnah Torah, the section on Yesodei HaTorah, the whole book, Guide for the Perplexed, all kinds of difficult philosophical books like these are kind of like adored and revered, but not studied, at least not formally. You got to study it privately, with the rabbi who really knows and so on. That's what the Forbidden Gate is all about. Now, I wanted to say one other cool thing about Sufism here I really find fascinating. So how is it possible that this such a frum, Sephardi Dayan, a Sephardi judge, could borrow from the Muslims and incorporate it into Yiddishkeit? And as I began to say a little earlier, it's all about that syncretic nature of Andalusian Jewry that was so special. If you think it's so unusual, however, I would like to say that maybe not. Maybe this is actually something about Jewish culture that we still enjoy today. We'll have more to say about this, God willing, about how it transitions to Christian Europe, but I would like to draw to your attention a popular song that you may have heard. In fact, if you walked outdoors any time over the last 6 or 8 months, you probably heard Despacito. It's a very popular Latin song. The word Despacito, I will not sing it. It's a very catchy tune. It's almost all in Spanish. And Despacito means slowly. And if you're not thinking about the Spanish and not listening to the words, then it sounds like a catchy sort of pop tune. But if you happen to watch the video, which I do not recommend, kids stay far away from this one, it's a Latin love song. It's totally inappropriate. It doesn't get anywhere close to appropriate. Despacito. Nevertheless, check out this video. David, we can leave it running, but I'm going to actually cut this out of the internet version. I'll put the link in because of copyright versions. If I put a video in a video, I get in trouble. So here is a Jewish take on Despacito, and let's pause to discuss it afterwards. Wow. You know? Mi ka'amcha Yisrael goy echad ba'aretz. You know, these Jews are so amazing. We take this schmutzig song, it's totally not okay, and we like the word Despacito, we like the tune, and then we just totally transvalue it. We eat the fruit and we throw away the peel. Now just think for a second, 100 years from now, you may have, you know, in the back of some library in the digital archives, someone might come across this Latin pop song that they sang in 2016. But then you go to a Jewish day school and the kids will be singing the Hebrew version of it with these lyrics, and it'll be alive and fresh and moist. It'll have like real chiyus to it. This is what Jewish culture is all about, that we, because we live as a minority, because we live in a multilingual, multicultural environment, we're able to kind of like grab things that have value, transvalue them into a Jewish system, and ultimately, once it's digested, it becomes Jewish, like egg rolls. Right? I haven't had supper yet. So that's what I'd like to think is happening with Rabenu Bahya using Sufi sources. Here's a Sufi teaching of great deep spiritual depth, great value, very profound. And he says, you know what, I can take that. And he brings it into his work, and now it's become a Jewish classic. I don't know Muslim history well enough to wonder how many Muslims are actually studying those Sufi teachings. But if you go, for example, to the shul just down the street here, two blocks over, I happen to notice they have 30 copies of Hovot ha-Levavot on the shelf. So Rabenu Bahya's work, it's still being alive and studied just three blocks away, across the street in the Baal Shem Tov library, everywhere. That is something about being the eternal people that is incomparable. Okay, let's go on. Oy Vesmir, so much to say here. But that was fun, wasn't it? Yes, I think so. Right, okay, so the foundation of it. So these are the gates that he describes in his work. There are 10 of these gates. Each one of them builds on the other. The idea is he describes kind of like a passage through each of these gates as you slowly climb to a higher madrega, a higher level of self-awareness and of ethical perfection and of spiritual purity and oneness with you know, the God's purpose here. The first gate we've talked about, the forbidden gate, it's actually called the gate of unity, which is Shar HaYichud, which is referring to the unity of God. Then next gate he gets to is called the gate of discernment. And this is also a fascinating Andalusian kind of thing. It's very much about science. He says, if you want to know God, You know, what did God give us to know about God? God gave us this amazing universe that we live in. And he says, so you got to study the universe. You have to know astrology. He has a whole passage on the astrolab that was like the big invention of the day. It's like the iPhone of the day. He says, you have to know iPhones. They're great. What you can do with them. and he goes through like, you know, the natural world, and you have to appreciate biology, and you have to appreciate all these various sciences, because that's how we come to know God, through our experience of the material universe. This is one of my favorite passages. He goes through, for example, human development. He talks about how amazing it is that, you know, children develop inside their mother's wombs, and they don't need to breathe, and they don't need to eat, and things like that. And he goes through how children grow. Let me just translate this one part. I actually pulled my wife aside to read this to her. Ve'achar kach, who, the child, who over mitkufat hayaldut el tkufat hanarot. And then the child moves from the stage of childishness to being an adolescent. Ve'horav ena mo'asim bo. And his parents are not disgusted with him. Ve'ena misragzim amash etzrachav rabim. And they don't get angry with him because he needs so much. And they don't get angry that he doesn't recognize how much they've sacrificed for him. You have a feeling that he probably wrote this when he was the parent of teenagers. And the fact that they give him everything he needs, and the fact that they protect him from all harm. And the fact is, the parents even worry about him more now that he's an adolescent. Until he becomes adult. Until he becomes an adult and he learns to speak and comport himself properly like a human being. Right? So, I'm sorry, I found that more funny than you did, I think. But the idea is, like, it's one of the evolutionary stages. It's so amazing. God created this universe that parents don't throw out their teenagers. You know, that's, some people are nodding. Anyways, so that's in the gate of discernment. It's all about discern in the case of, like, see what the universe has to offer and understand God's presence in it. Very powerful. The third gate, wow, this is called the gate. It's because someone's typing this and getting distracted by something. The gate of divine service, Avodas Elokim, which is all about, okay, so now you understand a little bit about God is, you see God in the universe, well, get to work. It's all about now applying yourself and not just showing up in shul for minyan. It's about how to daven properly, how to like put your soul into what you're doing. Wow. The fourth gate is perhaps the most studied of anything in the book. I went through it today. It was transformational, as always. The gate of trust, of bitachon, how to trust God. Very, very hard. If we had more time, there's one section I wanted to read to you. Seven ways in which a person learns to trust God, one after another. Like, you have to trust in this way, and then you have to learn to trust in this way. And reading a chapter like that just gives you such a sense of wellness and such a sense of calm and a sense that, you know, the universe is my friend because God protects me. It's a phenomenal classic work of Jewish thought. Gate of unity of purpose, subjugation, repentance, self-analysis, gate of separation, which was referring to the idea of like, you don't have to have everything. You can like live a life that's a little bit more modest. And finally, the ultimate, the gate of the love of God, which is also where Maimonides ends his famous book on repentance, where it's all about learning to love God, which is much more than we can say in this brief time that we have here. Oh, the last part of the book is the only thing that we have in Rabenu Bahya's own words, because he wrote them in Hebrew. And this is a passage which is called the Rebuke, the Tochacha. It's a very beautiful poetic passage of a few pages in length, in which he speaks to his soul in the first person. He speaks to his soul and how he needs his soul to like focus and be disciplined and realize the huge task that lies before it. And then the last part is the bakasha, in which it's after taking responsibility in his soul for what he has to do, then he has a long prayer to God. He has a discussion in the 10th chapter in which he says, you know, he exhorts people to read the Tochacha and the Bakasha, these two sections, with some regularity after having said a few cycles of the Psalms and things like that in order to develop spiritually to the next level. I personally, I've gone through Chovos HaLevavot before, but I totally forgot it, and I don't know anybody who actually follows this regimen. I'm going to ask around some of my rabbi friends and see if they can enlighten me as to who actually keeps this practice, because it's a very beautiful one that I think will be wonderful to revive. It's printed in the rabbi's own words in Hebrew at the end of the book. So, moving to his legacy, here's the Feldheim edition. I hope this inspires some of you to perhaps pick up Chovos HaLevavot if you've not read it yet and make your way through it. Skip over the first chapter. You know, you don't need to, you go straight to the second chapter. But it is a work of a phenomenal creativity, and it's quite unique in that it starts off this whole new genre in Jewish literature, focusing on self-analysis, self-development, spiritual growth that will really flourish in so many different ways. There are really four different schools of Musar that develop from the Chovos HaLevavot. Each is very different and catering to a different kind of personality. You have halachic Musar, which you see much more with Maimonides, for example, Kabbalistic Musar with Rabbi Moshe Cordovero. You know, we can go on and on, but the idea is it all really comes back to Chovos HaLevavot. I feel extremely grateful for having the opportunity to discuss this tremendous book and this great figure with you. And I look forward to learning with you in 2 weeks. We're not meeting next week, as I remind you. And I hope you all have a fantastic week. Thank you. Hello everyone, this is Henry Abramson speaking. I am so delighted to be the historian leading the Douro River cruise in 2018 as we will make our way along the Douro River from the shoreline in Portugal into Spain with kosher riverboat cruises. This promises to be an absolutely fantastic experience, both from a cultural level as well as an educational level, and of course, in terms of creature comforts, the boat that we'll be traveling on, I don't even think we can use the word boat. It has to be like a ship or maybe a vessel or something like that. Looks like an absolutely amazing experience. Wow, I'm so thrilled with the idea of spending some time with the kind of bright, motivated, intelligent students that I'm used to here in Brooklyn and on the internet as we explore the unique features that allowed Sephardic Jewry to develop in such an unusual way. We'll be looking at the entire gamut of Sephardic Jewish history, all the way from the ancient settlements from the Roman period and before into the Visigothic era, and then looking at the golden age, of course, of Jews in Muslim Spain and Al-Andalus, and into the much more difficult period of the Inquisition, the expulsions, and so on. And I'm hoping we'll also spend a fair bit of time looking at the phenomenon of the crypto-Jews, those Jews who chose to disguise their identity in order to maintain their existence in a very tenuous environment, and look at how they made a major impact, not only on the populations of the Iberian Peninsula, but also into Europe, the Middle East, and North America as well. This is going to be an absolutely fantastic experience. I'm looking forward to participating with you. I hope you'll visit the website to learn more. There's so much information there about the specific locations that the boat will dock and the vessel will dock. And we're working on the educational program right now. We're going to try and make sure that we can take advantage of all of the architectural and archaeological and cultural spots that we'll be able to visit along the Douro River. Wow, this is going to be amazing. I'm so glad my wife, God willing, will be coming with us as well. And she will have a lot to offer, I'm sure. So I hope to see you on this trip. I'm really looking forward to it. And thank you very much for listening. Please enjoy this very beautiful video. Thank you.